We're here today to talk about the Internet of Things and how that relates to the criminal world. I'm really excited about this panel today because these are three gentlemen that I've had the pleasure of working with extensively, but I also call them friends. So I think you're going to really enjoy hearing from them today. First, I'll introduce myself. My name is Jordan Ray Kelly. I'm a senior managing director in the cybersecurity practice at FTI Consulting. Prior to joining FTI, I most recently served as the director for cyber incident response on the National Security Council at the White House. And prior to that, I was the chief of staff in the FBI's cyber division. I'm going to briefly introduce my distinguished colleagues, and if they want to tell you a little bit more about their backgrounds, I'll certainly welcome that. But I'm also going to be asking the questions today, and we'll try to leave some time at the end for you guys to ask some questions too. Scott Ferber is a partner at King & Spalding, where he works on global privacy and data security issues. Prior to this, Scott held a number of senior positions at the Department of Justice, where he led national security cyber investigations, in addition to providing counsel to the Deputy Attorney General and the Attorney General on cyber issues. Scott previously served as Assistant District Attorney in the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. Anthony Ferrante is a Senior Managing Director and Global Head of Cybersecurity at FTI Consulting, and my boss. He has previously served as the Director for Cyber Incident Response at the National Security Council at the White House. He was also the Chief of Staff for the FBI's Cyber Division, and he was a member of the FBI's Cyber Action Team, which is a fly team of experts who deploy globally around the globe to respond to the U.S. government's most critical cyber incidents. Ari Maharis is the special agent in charge of the New York field office. He has oversight of both our counterintelligence and cyber programs there in the New York area. Ari has also served as the FBI's legal attaché in Athens, Greece, and is a supervisor on the Joint Terrorism Task Force. Ari was also an executive in the FBI's counterterrorism division and the chief of staff of the FBI's national security branch. So we're going to start today by talking about the rise of IoT devices. I'd like to ask you guys to talk a little bit about what the growth of IoT devices has looked like, and how do we expect to see them continue to grow in the future? All right.
Good morning. Thank you, Jordan. And I want to briefly thank everybody who's sitting in the audience. I know this is an early session, but I really appreciate you taking the time to be with us here today. As we consider the growth of IoT, we can see that that has expanded and grown tremendously over the years. In addition to each and every one of you having a device probably on you, if we looked carefully enough in this room, there's probably three, four, maybe five IoT devices that is helping building management and building productivity, whether it's heat, lighting, or even airflow. So the increase of IoT devices, I think, is tremendous. And some stats to support that, back in 2012, it was estimated that we had about 12.5 billion devices that were connected. By 2018, that number increased to 20 billion, and by 2022, it is estimated to increase to 30 billion. Cisco estimates that IoT business will be somewhere in the vicinity of $14 trillion by 2022. So not only are we having an increase in the proliferation of devices, but it's also a huge business for companies, organizations, and even us as individuals to consider. One of the reasons I believe IoT continues to grow and proliferate is because the transistors, the sensors that are used in these devices, the cost of them has plummeted. And that has allowed the manufacturers to not only increase the speed in the design, but also in the production of moving these items to market. And that the lower price of these sensors are now being attached to historical dumb devices. What do I mean? So dumb devices, whether it's a forklift or a container or a trailer, these are devices or equipment that historically had a single use purpose. The forklift will take the product off of the shelf, put it into the container, and then onto the trailer. Each one of these areas now has a device on it that is relaying information to the logistics manager, providing real-time information to help them speed up and become more efficient in their supply chain. So that's another reason why we're seeing IoT devices grow in the industry. Looking forward, I think we're going to see more devices connected, not just wirelessly through the internet, but on cellular. And with the advent and 5G right around the corner, those IoT devices that have a wide area application and can rely on cellular networks to achieve scale, I think we're going to see a huge move in that direction And I think the latest report I read was about 500 million, a half a billion devices are already connected to cellular, and that will probably increase.
So I would just add to what Ari just said. Of course, we all know IoT devices are growing at an incredible pace. I think the average, Ari might have touched upon it, but an average person has 3 to 4 IoT devices on their person at any given time, right? Whether it's a mobile phone or multiple mobile phones, a Fitbit, a watch. And what's important to note, and one of the reasons why we wanted to do this panel, as four investigators, government investigators, and now some of us in private practice, is that these IoT devices are creating data constantly. They're constantly creating data about what we do, how we feel, what we think, where we go, how quickly we get there. And that data is being pulled and stored in different places. And as an investigator, and those of you who are investigators in the audience can think, that could be a gold mine as you investigate different matters. So.
And then just so I can also talk on this first subject, forgive the lawyer in me. You know, it yes, IoTs are their growth is expanding exponentially, and just the advancement of technology is moving so quickly that it's hard to see around the corner. And my fellow panelists Ari and Anthony touched on this, but I think just to put a fine point on things, I don't know if any of you saw the May 2018 report that the Departments of Commerce and Homeland Security prepared to the president. And in that report, they assessed that market incentives weren't in sync with cybersecurity for these types of devices. So really the focus from manufacturers, from distributors, from vendors is, as Ari and Anthony had mentioned, cost and time to market without really an appreciation for the cybersecurity of the devices. And you know, we'll walk through some of these issues. So it's great, yes, that lots of data is being collected and used for the betterment of humanity and how we make decisions, how we exercise. But there is a concern and a lack of appreciation, I submit, by companies, by end users, of the type of information that's being collected, what's being done with it, and how it's being protected. And I'd also just add one point. It's just, you know, kind of serendipitous being out here in 2019. So 20 years ago, Kevin Ashton, you know, had this epiphany about brown lipstick tubes, and that's kind of credited with being the start of IoT. And here we are now, 20 years later, and the numbers being kicked around. I mean, just to kind of contextualize it, 30 billion devices, that would be 3 or 4 devices for every man, woman, and child on the face of this earth. So from lipstick to that coverage is just incredible.
Thanks, Scott. That's a great transition to what I'd like to ask you guys to talk about next, is really getting into the benefits and risks of IoT devices. We think of IoT as increasing the quality of life for a lot of people, but it's also enticed cyber criminals to commit fraud in new and novel ways. What are some of the risks that we should think about when we're using IoT devices?
Let me start. So when we look at risk from the FBI perspective, we're thinking of both security and privacy. And so that cyber actor, that cyber criminal who is interested in specifically targeting IoT devices, they typically have the time, the resources, and the technical know-how to get into a vulnerable device and steal what everybody has said, and Anthony mentioned it just before, there is a lot of information being generated on these IoT devices, so they're looking to get that information. And once they do get the information, I think what's at risk is the monetization of that information, which is now impacting privacy for the most part, and certainly the security of the device leading to the compromise of the privacy, and so they'll like to monetize that for illegal purposes. I think just as significant and maybe more significant, if we keep in mind the example I gave in the previous answer of the supply chain with the forklift, the products off the shelf into the container onto the trailer, what if the criminal, the cyber criminal now begins to alter and attack the integrity of the information? So now that the information that is being fed back to the logistics manager, that manager is making decisions on altered information, which is bad. And so that has a huge negative impact on the entire process. We're also concerned certainly of more sophisticated nation state actors or maybe even a terrorist. And in that context, it's not just theoretical, because they can take information and begin to target individuals or organizations. And there was a news report a little while ago of how information gleaned from exercise devices, fitness devices, the information was able to yield the specific location of a U.S. military forward operating base that was located in a conflict area. Well, you say, well, how'd that happen? Well, those soldiers who were engaging in exercise along the base and running around the perimeter so that they can have the appropriate distance to get in the maximum amount of space in their run, well, what they did was they took the information that those fitness devices were yielding and were able to overlay that on a map and show a specific location, outline, and perimeter of that base. So that had afforded the criminal, the organization, whoever was responsible for that compromise, the opportunity from a distance to specifically locate a military base. Ostensibly, had that person been required to be physically present, then the military security could have potentially caught those people in and around that area. However, they were able to do that. So that's what is important. When we consider the value of the information that the IoT devices collect and how they store it.
The only thing I would add to that, and I swear we're not going to speak one, two, three every time.
Does that mean I'm not allowed to talk after you?
Yes, we'll mix it up. The only thing I'd add to that is Ari gives a really good example of speaking about looking at it from a much bigger perspective. The only thing I would say is I would bring it closer to home. And remember, a lot of these IoT devices, people are actually inviting into their home. Right? IP cameras, baby monitors, thermostats, smart devices that you can talk to and ask questions of. These are things that people bring to their home. They plug in for ease of use. They're very easy to configure. And within minutes, they're up and running. Those are also devices that can surveil you, that they can be compromised. They're watching, learning. It brings it a little closer to home.
You don't get to talk next. Actually, Anthony, I'm going to go right back to you and ask you to talk about some of the technical vulnerabilities in IoT devices that people need to be aware of.
Well, I would start by saying these devices, as I just said, these devices are meant to be plugged in and fired up in a matter of minutes. And because of that, they need to be consumer friendly. They're not very complicated to set up. And because they're not very complicated to set up, it's very easy to understand as a malicious user or a malicious actor how to break into some of these systems. Passwords are usually hard-coded. The user manuals are publicly available online. You know what, not to get too technical, but what ports they're communicating on. How you could scan the internet to look for these devices. There are tools publicly available that can help you identify weak or open devices. And again, those devices can range from the IP cameras in your home to the smart devices, the voice-assisted devices, but then also other devices that may be operated from a cloud-based infrastructure, for example, a Fitbit. Breaking into an account like that can also yield you very personal information about the user of that Fitbit.
Ari, you want to tell us a little bit about the technical vulnerabilities from your point of view?
Sure. I think Anthony raises many good points, and if we're really interested to get a good look at what vulnerabilities exist with IoT devices, I think the OWASP has a really good list of a top 10. So if you're really interested in getting into detail, go there. But some of the things that come to mind for me is the insecure data transfer and storage, right? We've already identified the value of the information to some extent that these IoT devices collect and transmit and store. The inability to transfer that information or to store that information anywhere on the ecosystem, whether it's data at rest, data in motion, or in the process, I mean, without encryption is a bad idea. And that's a huge vulnerability in terms of the compromise of the information or maintaining the confidentiality of that information. Insecure default settings, I think Anthony already mentioned that. The default settings, the inability, so again, the manufacturers are interested in moving the product to market very quickly, and so they send it out to the market with insecure default settings. But more importantly and more problematic is the inability to actually change the configurations and make them secure once the client receives it. So I think that's problematic. And then also the lack of device management, right? The ability to update software firmware on these devices, I think, is also an issue. But again, I would actually refer our audience to the OWASP that has a really good top 10 list of technical vulnerabilities.
You guys have done a great job setting the stage of why IoT devices are potentially insecure. So that really opens the door to ask the question, what are the risks then for consumers and businesses? What kind of information are they potentially going to be liable for if it's inappropriately extracted from their IoT devices? And to what extent are they liable for malicious activity that's conducted via their devices? I think, Anthony, you have a good story to share with us about this one.
So I actually do have a really great story. And what many in the audience don't realize yet is you're looking at an all-star team up here on stage. In addition to us being on stage, we also have additional all-stars in the audience. Phil Celestini, we have Courtney Klein in the back, and Jillian Stickles in the audience. But seriously, I want to tell you a really interesting story. Raise your hand if you have a DVR at home, right? Most of the audience. IP camera, internet-connected device, right? Most of us have an IoT device. So the reason why I tell you we have an all-star team up here on stage is because leading into the 2016 U.S. presidential election, this team, everyone on stage and the others I pointed out in the audience, played a very critical role in the cybersecurity preparedness and response efforts leading into the 2016 presidential election. And approximately 10 days before the election, you may or may not remember, there was a large-scale internet outage in the United States. For approximately 1 hour, four separate times throughout the course of the day, I believe it was a random Tuesday or Wednesday, the internet went out in the United States. Of course, the internet continued to function, but a very critical service on the internet, domain name resolution, stopped working, DNS. In addition to it not working in the United States, there were pockets in Europe where the internet stopped working as well. So, of course, this created chaos. No one knew what was going on. As far as they knew, they went to their home computer, typed in CNN.com, got nothing. Typed in Twitter, got nothing. Typed in Amazon, got nothing. Facebook, nothing. No one knew what was going on. I was working at the White House. My phone rang, and they said, "What's going on?" I said, "I don't know. Let me call my colleague at the FBI." I called Jordan. Jordan called Phil, who was working at the NSA at the time. We called Scott Ferber, who was at DOJ. And then we called Ari Maharis, who was in the field in New York, commanding the largest cyber force on the face of the planet. So this was early in the morning. We had no idea what was going on. At the White House, my job at the time was to choreograph U.S. government response efforts. So I called the Department of Justice. I called the FBI. I called the Department of Homeland Security. At that point, they didn't know. So we continued to call the Department of Defense, the National Security Agency. No one knew what was going on. The internet started working again. We're okay. 90 minutes later, it happened again. The internet stopped working. Now, the West Wing is getting nervous. People don't know what's going on. To make matters worse, again, remember, we were 10 days before the 2016 US election, presidential election. We were worried about foreign actors influencing and causing chaos on election day. Again, to make matters worse, the New York Times publishes a breaking news alert. Russia is targeting US internet connectivity and has taken down the internet in the United States. So it was a very tense time. Fortunately, Ari, again, commanding his troops in the field, sent a few agents to a small technical company in New England. They knocked on the door, and the agents said, "This is going on," and the technicians at the company said, "We know, we don't know how to stop it. We are under attack." Long story short, as we discovered what the issue was, we prevented it from happening again. There was a vulnerability in that technical company's infrastructure. The FBI launched a large-scale investigation with support from DOJ, and the FBI traced it back to two individuals in the state of Texas, two 16-year-old kids who were playing Sony PlayStation games, and who had found on the internet the Mirai botnet, modified it, and used it to attack each other to try to knock each other off the gaming system. The reason why I tell you that story is because that botnet, the Mirai botnet, hijacked IoT devices. So I asked you to raise your hand if you have a DVR at home, if you have an IP camera, any sort of interconnected device. Those were all used. You could have been a part of this attack on the internet 10 days before the United States presidential election that received super high interest from the President of the United States on that random Tuesday or Wednesday before the election. Many people ask me, where are those two 16-year-old kids now? And I'm very happy to report, and I can say this, because I am not an employee of the Department of Justice anymore, but those two kids are now, they now work for the FBI. It's totally a joke.
I can't confirm that.
Totally a joke. But no, it's an interesting story. I'm glad to be able to share it with you, but it just demonstrates the power of IoT devices and the chaos that can be caused.
Thanks. Scott, can you just talk more generally about liability, not necessarily in the scale that he's talking about, but what we should be thinking about?
Certainly. You know, this is still an evolving area, but as Ari mentioned at the outset of our panel today, the two drivers for potential legal liability in this area are privacy and security. And what you see on and I won't get too in the weeds, but on a legislative level, is every single state in the U.S. and Puerto Rico has some combination of data breach notification, consumer protection, or privacy law on the books. And they're not always in harmony. So they're shifting obligations that companies must contend with in terms of the cybersecurity of their systems and what type of information they collect and what they do with it, with whom they share it. And California, for those who are familiar with the law here, recently passed a Consumer Privacy Act, the CCPA, which goes into effect in 2020 and is really expansive in terms of what it covers and requires of California businesses. And if you look at the definition, California businesses basically, and virtually any company that does business in California is going to be covered by this law. And the reason I bring it up is, one, because of how it defines personal information, which is not just electronic, but also the civil liabilities that covered companies will face if they don't maintain reasonable security standards for their systems. And so we're just, you know, California, where California goes, the country tends to follow. So California has this far-reaching law that's passed. It has a mechanism for victims, consumers, to file lawsuits. There's also enforcement authority by the Attorney General. And we're starting to see other states interested in considering similar type of provisions. So I think we're going to see more of that on the horizon. Federal regulators, state attorney generals are also very active. The FTC, which is tasked with policing unfair competition, fraudulent practices, deceptive practices affecting consumers, not only have they issued guidance with respect to IoT, but also have been very muscular in pursuing enforcement actions against companies who either aren't maintaining reasonable cybersecurity standards, are falling short of what they're claiming to do, or using data in a way that they shouldn't. And there are a bunch of different examples. I won't go into all of them. You have the FCC involved in the regulation of IoT devices. California, you got CCPA. They also recently and are the first state to pass a law requiring reasonable standards for IoT manufacturers. So that will go into effect in January 2020. The SEC for publicly traded companies have pursued enforcement actions for certain responses to material cyber events, either the disclosure of them or their handling. The big example I guess I can offer is Yahoo Altaba, who was the subject of an SEC enforcement action. And I think when the dust settled, between fines, attorney fees, and damages, they wound up paying over $200 million. And that number is significant because although I can't point to a trend or a law that would say that you know, there's going to be civil litigation with respect to the scenario that Anthony described, or something else where an IoT device is hacked into, or there's some type of damage caused by the lack of reasonable security standards on the system or the misuse of it. Where you have massive cyber attacks and you have victims sustaining multi-million dollar losses, they're going to be looking for other pockets to help recoup those losses. And if they can't file a lawsuit in the nation state scenario, if they can't sue the hackers from, you know, fill in the blank, North Korea or China or Russia, they may turn to other companies that have not participated in the malicious conduct, but were part of the causal chain. One recent example of that, and this is, for those of you who are familiar with the Swift heist, the $81 million theft that is credited to a North Korean-supported hacking team, the bank, the victim bank, the Bangladesh bank, who was the victim of the $81 million theft, recently filed a lawsuit in New York federal court against a Philippines bank that was part of the chain of the theft of the money, and the Philippines bank, as alleged in this lawsuit, facilitated the movement of the money from the Bangladesh bank out into the pockets of the hackers through casinos in the Philippines. And the lawsuit is alleging that the Filipino bank had lax security controls that facilitated the theft of money. And so that's an example. I'm not saying it's a harbinger of what's to come, but if you look at signs, if you see cases like that, and that's not the only one out there, I think there's going to be greater interest from victims of massive attacks to look to third parties, whether it's the banks, whether it's an IR firm, whether it's the manufacturer of an IoT device, to try to bring them in to recoup some of their losses.
Thanks, Scott. Well, now that we've heard a little bit about some of the risks and liabilities, I'd like to ask you guys to talk how we can secure these IoT devices. What are the innovations that we can leverage to help protect operations that use IoT devices? Anthony?
So I'll start with that one, and I welcome my colleagues to add any additional color. And it, you know, the first thing that comes to mind is I want to say that I fully support IoT devices. I love them. I have many of them in my home. I have many of them on my person. I just think they add tremendous value to our everyday lives, tremendous comfort and convenience, and I fully support them. That said, as a professional risk manager, you have to, right, manage those risks. And the first thing that comes to mind when I think about risk management and IoT devices, and I really put it in basic terms, is remember the old term, there's no such thing as free lunch. And I think it holds true in security as well, especially when it comes to technology and security. Anytime you buy a device or software or you configure something, you don't take the easy way out. Don't just take it home, take it out of the box, plug it in, and set it and forget it. Because you leave yourself vulnerable. You want to understand how it's connected, how it works. Make sure that when you bring it home and plug it in and turn it on, that you're using the advanced security settings. Really simple stuff, like two-factor authentication. A couple weeks ago, or I believe it was a month now, there was a ton of news on the internet about Nest cameras getting hacked. Nest cameras did not get hacked. User accounts accessing Nest cameras got hacked. And the super helpful tip from Nest was, please turn on two-factor authentication, right? And I was reading about that, and I found the comments enlightening, because an article was really straightforward. It said, this is how you use two-factor authentication. And a lot of the people who were commenting on the article said, I didn't even know what two-factor authentication was. So, things like that. I would also say, back to my statement, there's no such thing as free lunch. When you look at buying devices, whether it's a smartwatch, a Fitbit, a voice-activated assistance device, don't let price be the driver. Buy from a reputable organization. I remember a long, long time ago, about a year ago, 2 years ago, chatting with colleagues in industry, and they were telling me about this IP camera manufacturer. You could buy these cameras for $20 flat. $20, you get a nice IP camera. And my colleagues were buying them and using them as baby monitors. They were bragging about how you can configure them, you set them up in the room, you put it on the baby's crib, and they were calling aunts and uncles and in-laws who lived the other side of the country, and they were saying, log into my IP camera and watch the baby. Months later, it's on the news, those cameras were watching whatever they were watching and also sending the data to a foreign country for surveillance purposes. So be careful what you're purchasing. Buy from reputable organizations. Don't let price be the driver. Lock down the account, lock down the device. Scott, Ari, anything to add?
No, I think Anthony is giving some good practical advice, and it's be cognizant of what you're doing. Think it through, make rational decisions of what security features that you can take advantage that you're not. Really get back to the basics. And I tie in like a public service announcement here with regard to security settings, using the advanced security settings. If we have children and they have Facebook, there's no way in the world a 10-year-old has 1,000 friends. It's not. It's almost like a competition amongst the friends, right? Who can have more friends? And that's not good because those accounts yield a ton of information. Besides the fact that you can take a photograph and reverse engineer it so you can identify the specific location and time of where that photo was taken. So maybe they now have a picture of your child in front of the school they attend, right? And I'm thinking very drastic, very far end, like critical stuff. If we can manage that though, then the smaller things are okay, but we've got to be cognizant of what security features we're taking advantage of and what we're not that are available to us. And hopefully rational decisions are being made in terms of what we're leaving off. The bottom line is get back to the basics and just be really deliberate in your process of how you are configuring these devices.
So in my role at King & Spalding, I advise clients, primarily companies, on data privacy and security issues. And the advice I'm about to offer for free to you applies equally to Fortune 50 companies, to your own home. And the important thing, whether you're a general counsel, whether you're the CISO, the CIO, or you know you just bought a new IoT device, I really recommend that you, either as a homeowner, person, or company, conduct an audit of what you have. What are your devices? And get your hands around you know what the devices are. To Anthony and Ari's point earlier, you know who manufactured them. Do some research. Make sure that you know your device, KYD, know your manufacturer, know what the devices are capable of, know the security settings, know what you have and what's being collected, and read the fine print. Go to the websites. I know it's not fun to read the user's agreement and the privacy agreement, but seeing what companies are doing with the information, how they're collecting it, with whom they're sharing it, what's part of their supply chain, so to speak, in the device that is now in your home or at your business, is very important. You want to be buying from companies that have a good record, a good track record, as Anthony mentioned, on security, that you can trust if there is a vulnerability, if they are the victim of some type of malign cyber activity, that they're going to be notifying you as the consumer, that they're distributing patches, that they don't have a default password that can't be changed. And so things like that are important. Know what you have, know what it's capable of, know that it's secure when it's connected to the internet, because IoT devices can be compromised within minutes if not adequately protected. And then practice good cyber hygiene. Rebooting devices is a good step. I know this may be very basic for this audience, so I apologize, but there's great guidance from the Department of Justice, from the FBI, on steps to take to ensure that, reduce risk for IoT devices.
Thanks. Now we know a little bit about what the risks are. Let's talk about what happens if we find ourselves being an actual victim of an attack that's leveraging IoT devices. How do you quickly contain such an incident, assess it, and respond quickly?
I'll start, and then I'd like to pass it over to Ari from the government's perspective. But I would just say, when an incident occurs, you want to go back to basic incident response, which is, first you need to be able to identify that an incident is occurring. Believe it or not, I believe the statistic, and Ari can correct me, but an average victim of an incident doesn't realize it for about 18 months. which is a scary statistic. But when you do realize that you, as an individual or your organization, is dealing with an incident, the first thing you want to do is be able to identify it and then contain it. Identification, containment, and then of course preserve and collect as much digital evidence as possible. And then of course you want to fully investigate that matter, not only internally, but maybe leverage outside experts and of course outside law enforcement.
Yes, yeah, so I think that's right. Going down through a classic incident response protocol is probably your best bet. Once you've identified an incident has taken place, let's look at the device. And in this day and age, we've seen some examples where the actual compromise has moved from device to device, bypassing mainstream devices like laptops and servers. And so if we think of that route, it becomes a lot more difficult to sort of figure out what happened and who's behind that. But once you've identified the compromised device, you're thinking about whether or not to take that offline. And then you're also trying to capture, and from the law enforcement perspective, quite significantly, that piece of information, that data that is going to be key and critical to conducting the investigation. So maybe there's an IP address, a MAC address, or maybe there's some malware signature on the storage that will help us identify what the issue is. Of course, you want to then eliminate that vulnerability, plug it if you can, and if you cannot, then maybe you need to take that device out of service until a technical solution is found for it. In this environment, one of the key things that can be of use to all of you in the event you become a victim is to have a pre-existing relationship with law enforcement. Now, as an FBI representative, I would advocate reach out to the FBI, but in the end, what's important is that you have contact somewhere within law enforcement to get the process started, to help you identify what the issue is, and be able to get you as an individual or the victim company back to normal operations as soon as possible. We within the government have the responsibility, and hopefully we're getting better at it, that if I receive a phone call that should be pushed over to another agency, I'm going ahead and making that connection for you. But at the end of the day, don't do it after the fact. If you have to, if that's the position you're in, then obviously reach out and ask for the help. But having a pre-existing relationship with law enforcement is important because most of the times, that's based on trust. The success of the investigation is based on a relationship of one of trust between the victim and law enforcement. And I would highlight, finally, that it's important to remember that the FBI, as an investigative agency, is not a regulatory body. And surprisingly enough, there are many people out there who get that confused. We're not regulators, we're investigators. Our job and our mission, our mandate, is to identify what happened, how it happened, and who's behind it so that we can not only stop the bleeding in this particular circumstance that we're dealing with, but we also want to do what we can to spread that now valuable information we've been able to determine based on the investigation to a broader audience within the sector to prevent that from happening again.
I just want to add another perspective to what we're just talking about. And this, I think Scott and I can sort of both tag team on this part. It's, you know, Ari just talked about, you know, the criminal aspects of these matters, right? Traditionally speaking, you know, and if this has to happen, of course, in an ideal world, unfortunately, the best case scenario would be potentially that you're the victim of something like this. And I say, you're probably thinking, why would that be the best case scenario? Because the last thing you want to do is be responsible for a major cyber attack being facilitated or conducted from your infrastructure to somebody else. Right. Remember, I just talked about the Mirai botnet, how it hijacked DVRs around the country, and then were used to attack a technology company. You all didn't know that, but imagine one day if you show up to work one day and the FBI is knocking on your door and saying, "We need to talk. Why have you been hacking or targeting one of your competitors?" You might scratch your head and say, "I had no idea I was doing that." Right. That's one element to that, the whole criminal aspect to it. What I would also add is that, and especially in my new role in private sector, we deal with a lot of these matters from the civil perspective, where organizations are looking to hold somebody responsible. I know Scott touched upon it earlier, but maybe it's not a specific organization who is in the supply chain of the attack, but maybe it's an insurance company. Insurance companies are most certainly taking notice of these activities, and when they need to pay out an insurance policy, or maybe they don't want to pay out an insurance policy, as we've seen in the news lately, there's going to be an investigation, and they're going to want to get to the bottom of what happened. And as Ari and I spoke about earlier, collecting evidence, analyzing that evidence, reverse engineering what happened, putting together a timeline of events, that's going to be very critical. There's going to be lots of data available that's going to help you do that. And I promise you, for a significant event, it will end up in court, and there will be civil litigation because someone eventually is going to have to pay for what happened.
Yeah, there is the civil liability, and those are excellent points. And having seen this issue from both sides, both as a prosecutor, investigator, and now representing companies who are going through malicious cyber events, I mean, there's the push-pull of one, trying to respond and drive the actors off the system, but also trying to figure out how it happened, how to, you know, hold accountable those that are responsible, whether it's referring it to law enforcement or pursuing civil relief. But just amplifying on what Anthony was discussing, yes, there's civil exposure. I mentioned the just a sampling of the statutes that are out there that could impose liability both from a civil standpoint and also a regulatory enforcement perspective. This is the direction we're going. You have state attorney generals that are understandably active in pursuing these types of matters. You have agencies like the FTC, the FCC, the SEC, among many others, that are also active. And just to pick one point up about SEC, they issued a memorandum back in October related to the requirements or their expectations that publicly traded companies would have appropriate, robust accounting controls in place to prevent cyber-enabled fraud. So that's just one example of what federal regulators are looking at and expecting from companies. Companies need to have their cyber house in order, so to speak. And if they don't, there are going to be some consequences to it. And so just, you know, we've talked a lot about things to do. If you're executing those things to do during an event and you haven't gamed out before, you haven't done exercises that build in what happens when the IoT devices are hijacked or go haywire, what it looks like to cooperate with law enforcement, what it looks like to bring in a third-party firm like FTI to help with incident response. If you haven't done that in advance, you're going to be really behind the curve if you experience a malicious event. And so it's important to do those types of exercises. Know what it's like in a hypothetical or academic sense of cooperating with law enforcement. I know that federal agencies would be more than happy to participate in tabletop exercises involving malicious events. So why not do it around a table as opposed to when your bottom line is on the line?
Great. Actually, I think we have about 5 minutes for questions. If you guys have anything else you want to add, I thought might open it up now.
Good morning. I'd like to know what the threshold is that actually gets the FBI's attention. We had a case involving, I think it was $50,000 or $60,000, phishing attack, wire fraud sent out, falsified CEO email, and not even a blink.
So I'll take that question. The scenario you're describing is, I suspect, a business email compromise or some kind of executive account compromise. And so that's a good question, and we get that. The first thing I'll say is when you are a victim or an individual or a company suffers that kind of a loss, report it. Report it to the FBI's website, ic3.gov. We may not investigate it because the FBI, like most organizations, is limited in resources, but we do collect the information. Why do I say that? It's important. I work in New York where I have the benefit of being the beneficiary of two really aggressive districts that will go after and chase whatever criminal activity they can, and that's the Southern District of New York and the Eastern District of New York. But just like we in the FBI, the prosecutors are also limited in their resources as well. So a $50,000 compromise will not be investigated, or more importantly, will not be prosecuted by the prosecutors in New York. In a smaller district, it may be.
So the first thing is to report it to the IC3.gov website. And the reason I say that is because what we are doing there is aggregating the information so that if we can connect that $50,000 theft to a wider organized criminal scheme so that now we have multiple victims with a greater amount of money that's been stolen, now that changes the dynamics of that particular scenario, and we can probably pull together a case that will be pursued by our prosecuting partners. And so, yeah, it's unfortunate that a $50,000 theft in New York may not get full investigation, but if reported properly and we make the connection and we have people back at headquarters that are constantly looking at this information, that may actually lead us to something bigger where we're going to dedicate resources now to figure out what's going on.
To what extent are you seeing or concerned about IoT devices being linked to more traditional forms of crime, physical theft, extortion, that type of activity?
So I think we can say that it's possible, right? Especially let's take the example of the Nest doorbell. We know that that takes video, and we know that that's stored, some of it locally, but some of it to the cloud as well. So if that's compromised or the account is compromised, I can begin to develop a pattern of life of you at home so I know when you're there, when you're not there, so I can connect that. And now if I'm a burglar, I can probably target your home. And I'm not taking just you out of the air. You're somebody that I've already done some research, some reconnaissance. You're a high net worth individual. I'm trying to figure out a way to get inside and grab some value from you. So to that extent, IoT devices in that environment can certainly be used. But Anthony hit on it. A simple two kids playing with the DYN Mirai attack, right? That was just something that happened on the side. But if we take the kids out of that scenario and put real criminals in there, maybe there could be one day more nefarious activity going on utilizing, leveraging IoT.
I would also say, you know, back to what we were saying earlier when we started this, you have to consider the amount of data that is being generated from these devices, right? Not only the amount of data, but the types of data, right? Think about it. You wake up in the morning and you're having breakfast and you say to your device, you know, what's the weather? You know, what's my agenda today? I mean, that is all data that device is collecting. Your tone of voice, who it is, right? Could be a man's voice, a woman's voice, right? This is all data that these devices are collecting. And if these devices, if these providers are compromised, it's going to take, you know, the criminal possibilities to a whole new level. I've actually been waiting all session to say this, but IoT devices actually give a futuristic upgrade to the term, anything you say or do can and will be used against you, right? It really does. And you have to appreciate that.
You know, I'm reminded of the famous quip, the bank robber, why do you rob banks? Because that's where the money is. And you see the increasing prevalence of things like business email compromise, ransomware. If fraudsters can figure out a way to make money from IoT compromises, they are. You know, the adage that black hats can attack anywhere, white hats have to defend everywhere. If there is opportunity, we're going to see the trend toward the exploitation of IoT devices. And that's why it's so important, all of the things that we discussed today, you know, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, being prepared, being aware, and knowing your devices is key.
Well, I think that's a great place to stop. Thank you guys so much for sharing your insights today, and thanks to all of you for joining us.
Thank you.